Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. Well, more and more people are having them. They may be in your family. What am I talking about? Twins. And my guest today, Dr. Joan Friedman, has written The Same But Different: How Twins Can Live, Love, and Learn to Be Individuals, and it's published by Rocky Pines Press. Welcome, Joan.
Thank you, Connie.
And truly a fascinating book because, you know, people have twins and they send you a picture and say, oh, aren't they adorable? Well, there's more than meets the eye.
That's so true.
And you yourself are a twin, which is what your practice specializes in.
That's right. I have an identical twin named Jane, and I also have fraternal twin boys, Johnny and David, who are now 25 years old. So I've had the experience from a lot of different angles.
Beginning with the fact of who was born first.
Mm-hmm. Beginning with who was born first?
Yeah.
Well, we told Johnny and David that we weren't going to tell them who was born first, because I had spent all of my adult life basically being identified as, oh, you're Joan, so you're 3 minutes older. And it's hard when twins are given these labels, mm-hmm. since they were very young. And even though parents do it to help other people, and maybe themselves, differentiate yeah. one from the other, it's a label and it sticks, and it interferes with sometimes people getting to know who twins are. So I had three rules when I found out I was having twins. One was they weren't going to be told who was older until they were like 13. The second thing was that we were going to spend alone time with each one of them. And the third thing was I told them from the time they could understand that they were going to go to separate colleges.
The reason I asked about that, because the two men twins, Gerald and Anthony,
mm-hmm.
and the fact that Anthony, who was younger, was always treated as if he was second rate.
Yes.
And then Gerard brings him into the business, and the business ends up being down the drain. And Anthony realizes he was not such a brilliant decision maker.
That's correct. And it really took Gerald coming to me, and we had a few sessions so that I could begin to try to help him see himself as an individual rather than as a dyad with his brother. He really had no one who ever really said, well, how do you feel? What do you need? What do you want? He always measured himself against his brother. And I would say that it was amazing in just a few sessions. He was really able to work through a lot of the issues that he had, because it finally took just one person to help him see himself as more separate.
Yeah, that's another problem that twins have, separating.
They have such a problem separating, and I have to hold most parents accountable.
Uh-huh.
And parents just don't seem to know that separating twins is so important. We're also taken up with what I call the twin mystique. Twins are soulmates. They're telepathic friends forever. They never want to be separated, and they're never alone. And so parents buy into this, like off the movies, books, everyone does, and then they project this onto the children, and the children in a way feel like they have to live up to that.
Yeah.
And so I come in as a professional and I'm saying, you know what, you really need to think about separating those children. And they go, why? They love being together. They don't want to be separated. I've asked them if they wanted to be separated, but they say no, so I'm not going to do it. So I'm sort of seen as this sort of very evil twin coming and saying, you really need to provide separate experiences for them if you want them to grow up and feel like they're individuals and they can be on their own.
So in a sense, for the parents, it's a shock when the twins don't get on.
It is a shock. It is a shock. I mean, lots of times parents will come and say to me, my twins fight so much. They're not supposed to fight. And I say, what would it be like for you if you were born in a marriage and you didn't get to choose your partner? You know, twins are born married in a sense with a partner they didn't choose. They've had to share everything from the time they were born and before. And why wouldn't they be fighting? They're fighting for everything. They're fighting for space, for mother's attention, for goods and supplies in their environment. It's understandable that they would fight.
And in one case here, we're talking about them going off to college. I forget which one, but she says, I don't want to be responsible for your social life. And she's hid her feelings all these years.
Well, going to different colleges is such a beef of mine because I have worked with so many families whose twins are ready to go to college and all hell breaks loose. And nobody seems to understand why. Usually one twin wants to separate, the other one doesn't. And the parents are at a loss as to what to do. So I can give you a wonderful story. One twin got accepted early decision, let's say to Vassar. Then her sister didn't know where she wanted to go, but she applied to Vassar, but hadn't made a decision. So she got into her schools, and lo and behold, she got into Vassar too. So she went to her sister, who had already gotten in, and said, is it okay if I go to Vassar too? And the twin who had already been accepted said to me later on in an interview, I couldn't be the one to decide that she could go or not go. How could it be my decision? And the reason I found out about these twins was their mother called me about 2 months into their starting college and saying to me, they aren't speaking to one another. They're not getting along. What happened? Yeah. And no clue.
Yeah.
Just no clue.
Now, what happens with codependency in such a case?
Well, the fact that they've even gone to school together is really a reflection that they are very codependent.
Yeah.
And often the twins I've worked with who have stayed together those 4 years have had a lot of issues during those 4 years.
Yeah.
Sometimes they grow apart and they grow separate in a very good way. Other ways, it's a very unhealthy codependence. What happens often after college is one might get a job. One might move to another city. One might have a significant relationship. Now, that's when the problems begin. Because the successful twin, who's maybe gotten everything she's wanted, is now guilt-ridden because her sister, who may not have a job, not have a relationship, and be depressed, is the one who's suffering. So the successful twin can't even enjoy her success because her twin is unhappy.
Yeah.
And that really causes a problem.
That it's very sad.
Very sad.
Yeah.
And more than sad, actually, it's sort of like they've delayed growing up and growing apart, which if they had been singletons, it would already have been done. But it's really like, you know how children have to separate from their parents? They have to separate from their twin. And it's very, very hard also because socially they're expected already by other people to be separate.
Yeah. And the one who separates and who's doing well begins to be guilty. There's a story here too about the two women who graduate college and end up back at home. And they have separate rooms, but one bought a TV set, so suddenly her room is not hers alone.
I know, and I remember speaking with those twins, and I said it was so clear that they couldn't live without each other and they couldn't live with each other. And neither of them was able to establish boundaries because they had been so codependent their whole lives. So even though they'd been away from college, they came back together and replicated their twin relationship all over again.
Now, unless two twins marry two twins, which has been known to happen.
Many times, actually.
And maybe that solves some problems.
Well, it may solve some problems, but I have a feeling that nobody is ever really a separate individual. But it's such a good question and a good subject, because oftentimes twins say, if you marry me, you also marry my twin. So they come as a package. I have a great story. These twins who were both married, who lived close to one another, one of their husbands came in and saw that on her desktop computer there was a picture. And it was just a picture of she and her sister. And her husband said, where do I fit in?
Yeah.
And it takes some work.
And there also was when one of the twins was both married and having a child. And it was really a shock to the other twin, because am I still going to be first?
That's right. And it often, you know, it's so interesting because twins are so competitive about so many things that sort of like one of those hidden surprises people may not know. Twins are competitive about how much money each of them makes, if whose house is bigger, who weighs more, who goes on a better vacation. You know, all you hear in the media are the fact that twins, you know, especially with athletics. Did you read about the biathlon and one twin gave up her position on the Olympic team because her sister couldn't practice or couldn't do the runs because she was ill, but she gave up her place to her sister. So you hear these incredibly altruistic stories about how twins take care of each other, but you don't hear kind of the undercurrent of how competitive twins can be and how unhealthy it makes their lives.
Because of the competition or because of giving up part of something in themselves that, you know, it's not healthy.
Well, when they've given up parts of themselves, they have really not developed their own self.
So you felt that about these two sisters, the biathlon.
I did. In fact, I wrote a little blog about it, and I talked about, I quoted Anna Freud, who talks about altruistic surrender. Altruistic surrender is when you feel that you're doing something for somebody that has the same values that you have. And it's kind of a defense against being separate and having your own self.
What about the child? Excuse me, when one of them has a baby.
And the other one doesn't. Oftentimes, there is some feeling that, and in fact, I heard this very thing at a conference, that one twin sister said, I'm no longer can be friendly with you because you have a baby. I want a baby, but I don't even have a husband. I don't have a baby. You have a baby, and now you're going to be all taken up with that baby, and you're not going to care about me anymore. And I'm, like you said earlier, I'm going to be second fiddle, and I'm not going to have anything to do with you.
Yeah.
And it's unbelievable because it's normal ambivalence to feel jealous toward a sibling who has more than you or who's married, who has a baby. That's normal because all of us don't get the same thing at the same time. But twins feel like that's the way they end it.
What about the twin who is the caretaker?
The caretaker twin is the one who, and that's who I was in my relationship with my sister. And you know,
would she agree if she were listening?
She would, but she didn't like that.
Okay.
And we were in a situation where I felt that I had to take care of her, and I think when we were little, she kind of got brainwashed into feeling that I did, but really grew to dislike the fact that I was the caretaker. And a funny story about this is that Jane and I had never been separated until we went to college, ever.
Yeah.
So we went to different schools in different states, and it was hard for us because we had never been separated. Our phone bills were enormous. But what we did was, in our situation in terms of making friends, is we replicated our twinship. I found somebody that I thought was sort of shy and introverted to take care of, and she found a very bossy and extroverted roommate that became her best friend. So we kind of, in a sense, continue that dynamic until I think we were both able to work it out in our own therapies. And when we had our own marriages and our own children, it sort of developed into a more normal way. But I think for us, a lot of that came from the fact that our parents sort of let us parent each other. You know, often parents see that twins love each other more than anyone else in the world, so they just figure they'll take care of each other.
Yeah.
So it's a kind of a mixed bag.
Interesting. How about when it's a male and a female twin?
They have very different and a lot less difficulties than same-sex twins because their gender allows them to differentiate. You know, they can just become a boy and become a girl. And I think the relationships that I've heard is that little girls, when they're little, the little girls happen to most of the time be dominant, and they push their brothers around, and then eventually that gets worked out as they get older. But cognitively, girls develop quicker, so in that dynamic, the girls are pretty much bossy and authoritative in those early years.
The sad one was Tessa and Chris.
Yes, yes.
She was sick at an early age. That had to have an effect on a twin who expects everything to be similar in each of us.
That's right. I mean, I have a lot of stories like that in the book where one is sick and one isn't, and, you know, or one has an illness and the other one doesn't. And, you know, it's interesting because people think that everything about twins is the same, or that's the expectation. And when one has an obvious illness, that one who's ill, and this also happens too, there's many twins that are born with one has a disability and one doesn't. So all of a sudden, from birth, there's an inequality, and you can't treat twins the same. And parents in this conundrum feel so guilty because a lot of the attention is going toward the needier twin.
Yeah.
And that happens as they grow, and it's a very difficult dynamic for a lot of families.
There was another one, a young girl who was 13, had cancer, mm-hmm. and the effect this had on her twin.
Yes, and that's interesting because the cancer was diagnosed in their adolescence at a time when they were already trying to establish a separation and their own identity. So the cancer automatically made one of them different and separate and distinct. And there were a lot of issues about how the twin that was sick felt that her sister abandoned her, and the one that wasn't sick was so overwhelmed and overcome and guilt-ridden by her sister's illness that she, in a sense, did abandon her, because at 13, she didn't have the emotional maturity to do anything else. And that was a very, very hard time.
What happened to them later on?
They're both great. The one who had cancer is just fine, and they're both continued their studies, and they've worked through a lot of their twin issues. They're able to talk about what they both were going through during their adolescence, during the time when one twin was ill, and they're really working on their own separation and individuation.
Fran and Gail were interesting because that, again, was one got married and pregnancy, and the threat almost feeling disloyal.
Yes, I don't know if that was exactly, but that Fran and Gail had parents who just assumed that they were going to take care of one another. So if one got married, the other twin, and these were in their late 20s, early 30s, the parents just expected that, okay, if Fran has the children, then whoever the other one is going to take care of that child. All of a sudden, your twin is going to be your built-in babysitter.
Yeah.
And they said no. Not going to happen.
The last chapter is claiming yourself.
Yes.
What do you mean by that?
I mean that twins in all different ages and all different stages have to go through a developmental time when they finally feel good about who they are, that they're separate, that they're not worried that their twin's going to be jealous or angry or competitive, that they're just going to feel not responsible, that they're going to be able to enjoy life as a separate person without feeling as if their success or their difficulties or their differences are going to impinge upon their twin. And this is one of the really big problems. And when people come and find me to talk to, they're so happy because they're afraid that if you come in and complain about your twin, that it means you don't love them. And how do you not love the person that you've loved your whole life? But it's really just helping them tease out that they want to be separate and they want to be able to live a life free from a lot of these twin difficulties that have impacted them for so long.
If you change one twin, do you have to change the other?
Well, that's a wonderful question. And as a psychotherapist, a twin is a system. It's a dyad. There's two people. And when you change one, there are definitely changes in the other. This happens. And some twins do beautifully with the change, some twins not. But that's what you have to take a risk when you go in therapy and figure these things out.
When it goes badly, what do you as a therapist do?
Well, it's kind of like when your couple's therapy goes badly. You know, you do the best you can, but then at that point, it becomes the twins' decision whether or not they can go ahead with how they want to live life in the face of the fact that their twin is angry or not speaking to them anymore or is just so upset.
Yeah.
It's an individual decision.
And I'm just curious, therapy for yourself as well as your sister?
Oh, we have been in therapy our entire lives. Okay. And continue to do so and continue to thrive. So I actually feel it's been so helpful to both of our defining ourselves over time.
That's one. What about with your husband and her husband?
Well, it was so funny. When I first got married, again, it's sort of like the roommate story, I would just automatically always call Jane. And my husband goes, why do you always call her all the time? Why aren't you talking to me? And I didn't even realize it was such a knee-jerk situation to just automatically connect with her.
Well, I have a sister who's 4 years older, mm-hmm. and I call her a couple of times a day. And she's in New York, and I'm here. So is that so unusual?
Well, the issue is that you feel completely free, and you want to call your sister. I think a lot of twins, having grown up together, it becomes sort of a compulsion, or you feel like you should, or it's knee-jerk. Like, I didn't consciously call Jane. I just called her because I grew up with her for so many years. She always was a part of me. Mm-hmm. So I had to sort of wean myself away from that relationship to make more room for my husband, really, and to make room for other things in my life that were sort of, again, no one's fault, but crowded out by my relationship with Jane that had really defined me.
How many children does she have?
She has 3 children.
Oh, no twins.
No twins. Yeah. She always says, I'm happy I didn't have twins. So I'm happy I did have twins because parenting my boys really helped me to kind of work through a lot of the issues that I felt that Jane and I didn't get from our own parents, and it's been a blessing.
That's great. Now, are the boys at the same school?
No, the boys are 25, so they went to different colleges, of course, and they one's living in L.A. and working, and one's living in New York and working, and they have a wonderful relationship, and the reason is, I think, because my husband and I worked hard to really have them be separate whenever they could. And I always like to say, they miss each other, but they don't need each other. And that's the crux of a healthy relationship. They don't need each other to live, but they miss each other because they really enjoy each other's company.
Ah. What do they do, by the way?
One of them is in licensing and branding, and the other one is in banking.
Oh, okay. Not dissimilar, but not the same.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well said.
Very interesting. And the others, do you think they will, well, of course you don't know whether they will have twins as well.
Well, if they do, they're going to be so lucky because I'm such an expert. I will intrusively tell them what they're doing wrong or not. So I don't think they want to have twins because they saw Johnny and David growing up and they saw that they had a lot of issues to deal with. And I'm so thankful that we had older children because they really did do a lot to raise Johnny and David, too. But they saw it wasn't easy.
Yeah.
And I don't know if they would relish the idea of having twins, but if they do, I think they feel happy because I'm going to be around.
Oh, that's wonderful. And in other words, you never dress them exactly alike.
Never.
Joan, thank you very much. Will you autograph my book?
I certainly will. And thank you so much for having interest in my passion.
Well, it's really, I think every family has a set of twins and it makes you everybody interested.
That's right. Or they have twins or they know twins and it's everywhere.
Yeah. And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com or go to Claremont Graduate Digital Library. They have digitized our first 5,000 shows. But whatever you do, support your local library. Books are so important today. It isn't just an e-book, and it isn't just something on your computer. It's something you hold in your hand, and that is part of what makes the library so important. What did the library mean to you growing up?
Oh, I love the library. I used to go to the library and read biographies of every woman that I was able to read about. And I really do feel that that gave me such an important sense of myself that I wasn't getting by being a twin. Because twins are always stars, but nobody knows who you are. You're noticed, but not known. So reading biographies of Florence Nightingale, Clara Barton, Amelia Earhart, I loved the library, and I still do.
Yeah. And you took your children to it.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I'm still going to the library.
Great. Because children, no matter who they are, where they are, remember who took them to the library and got them their library card.
So true.
Yeah. By the way, I do want to talk about a book that I have kept for 18 years from when I did the show with Marga Zsolta Niedzbitowska. Yes, that's the name. Called Remnants, The Last Jews of Poland. It is a brilliant book with magnificent photographs in it that her husband took. She was in this country doing a fellowship at Harvard at the Nieman Fellowship. Mm. But the photographs and how she ended up doing this book, because she said to her grandmother in Polish, which I do not speak, who are the Jews? What do they do? And why aren't there any here? Mm. Why do I read about them? Well, the grandmother said to her, well, I can't tell you all about it, but I'll say, your father's life was saved because it was a Jewish doctor. Well, one of those stories that one reads about or hears. This book has the essays that she wrote and the photographs her husband took. Many of them are really quite remarkable, and really a book. See, books are worth keeping too. And this was one I felt important to keep. Another book now is Louise Steinman's book, The Crooked Mirror. She has just spent 10 years going to Poland and writing a book about it now. But just some of the books we've liked recently, and we'll see you next time. Thank you, Joan.
Oh, thank you, Connie, so much.